very important condition that needs to be satisfied. We talk about people who live. What is the very important condition that has to be true for the movement for the world? Okay, there's one thing to say here is that if not expect, the velocity has to be small relative to the speed of light. This is true. Einstein has modified Newton's law, okay, by the Newton law number 2, that is the MA, to take into account of the moment to take the phenomena into account that when you go with velocities, overall with the speed of light. There's another condition. Or you don't want to do that. You don't want to talk about things that are near the speed of light, because that's what I mean, it's not correct. But we don't worry about that too much in this class. That comes in 2D, okay? If you think. So what other conditions do we have that must be proved? What do we clean off the hole? You have to be in an inertial coordinate system. Yeah? You don't know what you're talking about. Inertial coordinate system. What is an inertial coordinate system? How do I know that I am in an inertial coordinate system? What measurement can I do to say, yes, I'm in an inertial coordinate system? Boy, I know it's 9 o'clock, but still, what has to be pushed? Exactly. So to put it in a short one-liner to it, Newton's first law has to be proved. What's Newton's first law? Newton's first law says that a free body moves with a constant velocity. And the book says, all velocity equals zero. The velocity zero is also constant, right? So I just abbreviate it and say that Newton's first law requires that a free body moves at constant velocity. No acceleration, acceleration zero. If you see that, you can say, yes, I'm in an inertial coordinate system. And if you are, then all three laws of Newton hold. Okay? So it's a circular argument. If you first of all hold, I'm in an inertial coordinate system. Okay? And if I'm in an inertial coordinate system, Newton's first law holds. Okay? Are all coordinate systems inertial coordinate systems? No, if you examine all the coordinate system is not inertial. Everybody? Oh, it's simpler than that. I talked about one of them. Remember the elevator? And the book is talking about the elevator. You see Mr. Einstein standing in the elevator. What's he doing in the elevator? He's standing there. You all read the book here. Yeah? Part of the book last year. What did Einstein do in that elevator? Did he go to the fifth floor of Mayor Hall? No. He was standing on a scale. Okay? I see a lot of blank faces. I know it's 9 o'clock. Still, we must be right away here. Because this is important. So I want you, those of you that have no idea what I'm talking about, in this lecture in the quarter, you should really carefully study the 2 pages of the elevator with Mr. Einstein in it. Every word counts in that for those 2 pages, okay? It's not like a poem or a book that you read through from beginning to end. Here you have really until you get it completely. Yes? That's part. Another system, inertial coordinate system. If you are being swung around in a circle, you're not a free particle, right? We're going to talk about this, but imagine you're being swung around by a rope, okay? Or you're sitting in this dimension, one of those very go arounds, okay? That go very fast. Even if they don't go fast, that bucket that you're sitting in is not a good inertial coordinate system. Because you're being accelerated, right? You feel the force in your back. when I move around like this, I feel a strong force from the seat in the back. I'm not a thin particle. Okay? And therefore, I'm not moving in a straight line. I'm moving in a circle orbit, like this. This is the one I started with last time. Let me set it up again. I have a mass M. Mass M is attached to a mass of string. And now, or I might say a mass of bar, okay? It's a metal bar, very thin, very massless. It's attached here. But if you bend it, it can swing back and forth. And now this entire thing is going to rotate around the vertical axis, like this. It's rotating, like this. And I'm holding a mass of a string in my hand, okay, like this. What's going to happen to that mass? Turn around. You want to stay vertical? Mm-hmm. Well, if it is vertical, it stays vertical. But if it gets a little bit sideways, what will happen?
Mm-hmm.
It will go out, right? So there will be a certain angle there. The faster I go, the more this object will go out. So if I can fit it around this, it can do that. And I give you the example of you and all of your younger siblings being turn around by the feet, yes? You go very fast, then your sister or brother will go out at a larger and larger angle here. Why is this happening? So we did it quicker, right? You have the choice. It's happening because of the centrifugal force, or it's happening because of the centrifugal force. And about 70% of you thought it was the centrifugal force, and the other 30% thought it was the centrifugal force. Even though I told you the central group of forces don't exist, you still think you're doing this. What's really happening? Let's do this problem now. This object is moving along a circle, right? If I believe the draw in clear dimensions, it moves around the circle like this because this is rotating. Anything that moves along a circle is accelerated. So let's assume that I'm turning around at a constant velocity, okay? I'm not speeding up or slowing down. That means that this object is also moving at a constant velocity along the circle, right? Velocity is the same everywhere. Let's say that the velocity is V. The magnitude of this velocity is V. What's the acceleration that this object experiences? It must experience an acceleration, because it's on a circle. If it didn't have an acceleration, it would move according to Newton's first law. And move in a straight line. It's not moving in a straight line, it's moving in a circle. So there must be something that is changing the velocity vector to go from here to here to here to here. That's called an acceleration, right? The velocity is changing on movement. How large is the acceleration? The formula for that. B squared over r, where r is the distance from here to here. Okay? This is something you must know by heart. B squared over r, the formula is 2 for a for an acceleration and when the velocity is t, and the radius is r. Okay? There's nothing else you can do but memorize that equation. Okay, so let's study how this works. I'm first going to draw all the forces that are acting on this mass M. Now the force along the bar, right, on the string. I'm going to call that force T, the tension in the string. Is there another force acting on this body besides the string?
Yes.
Gravity. Thank you. So, I'm here. Anything else?
No,
the center of the force? Yes. So the centrifugal force is caused by the combination of those two forces. You'll see how. Okay? It's not that this is attracted to something here. That is not what's happening. There is electricity. There's no force from here to here. Directly. The force from here to here will be caused by this one and by that one. It's the result of those two forces. I'm sure how that works. So we use an coordinate system, of course, that we put the coordinate system at this. X to the left, and Y up. So my F equals MA, which is a vector relation, implies two other relations. F equals MA, and F Y, because I'm Eva. You don't care about the C direction. You need that alone. There's nothing to learn from the C direction. So you see that, that those three relations really translate into those two relations, one in the X direction and one in the Y direction. So here is an example of why it's important that you draw your angles, let's say 145 degrees, okay? Because now I immediately see that that data is also here. Does everybody agree to that? And if I extend this line, that data is also here. And I'm glad I made a big figure, because I'm filling it up with symbols very quickly. It's already getting a little too busy. Okay, let's do something in the Y direction. What's happening in the Y direction? Well, I make a projection of the tension in the vertical direction. This one. Okay? How big is this one? I know this is theta. T cosine theta. So let's do the Y direction. And that's T cosine theta. Plus or minus? Plus, because the plus Y is pointing up, and that thing is pointing up. What else do I have? Well, we talked about this, we have this force. It's exactly in the Y direction, but actually in the middle is Y direction. So what do I get?
Minus MD.
Okay? And what is at the right hand side? It's M times A by, right? M times A by. What's acceleration in the Y direction?
Zero.
Does everybody agree with that? Mm-hmm. It is not accelerated in the Y direction. Okay? The velocity in the Y direction, in fact, is zero. It goes around like this. It's zero forever. Right? If there was an acceleration in the Y direction, then it would get a velocity in the Y direction. It doesn't. It stays in the horizontal plane. Right? So that is zero. Now the X direction. And here from here, what do I see? I see that this force I can decompose. I have already taken the component in the vertical case, I can now also see that it's a horizontal force here. There is your centrifugal force, okay? You are waiting for it. How big is this one?
Cosine
theta. Okay? Plus or minus?
Plus.
Plus. Plus. Any other force acting in the X direction?
What about MG sine theta.
Perpendicular, right? So that doesn't have any component. If you take the projection of the gravitational force to go to horizontal, you get zero. This point ends up here. It's zero. Okay? So that is equal to M times A. X. I'm just copying this equation here. Okay? Now what is AX? Well, the acceleration in the X direction. We know that that is equal to V squared over R. So I'm going to substitute that. I'm going to write M V squared over R. Is there any other equation I can write down? No. I start with 2, I have 2. How many unknowns do I have? What are the unknowns here? You can just read it.
T
and somebody else's known? Well, say that, attention. Those are the two. I have two unknowns and two equations. I'm very happy and so should you be. Unknown. So with two equations, two unknowns, I can solve, right? So, by the way, you might say, hey, I also don't know p squared and I don't know r. This is true. Okay, I'm assuming that somebody tells me how fast I'm rotating. And r is just an equation that is actually related to this angle and the length of the string. Okay, this r is equal to the length of the string times sine or cosine. Sine, theta. So I know it. If I know theta, I know it. And I assume, I should have told you this at the beginning, that I know the length of the string. So let's solve for these equations. I'm going to solve for, what should I do? I'm going to solve for theta. Or should I solve for t? I can solve for t first, right? So I take this is equation 1, this is equation 2, I take equation 1, and solve for t. So t equals mg divided by cosine theta. And then I put that t into the second equation, right here. So I write mg over cosine theta, that's equation 2. Here, times sine theta. And then on the right hand side, the way around, I have mv squared. What is sine theta over cosine theta?
Tan theta.
Tan theta. With I write tg and you write tan, let's write tan theta equals mv squared over r. And then I have to divide by this mg, right? 1 over mg. G. Something interesting happens. You see that? M cancels. So I get p squared over r. Wow, it doesn't matter for the angle how happy this is. You see that?
And that yeah. RG.
Pardon?
Your and R, these sort of RG has gravity field.
I'm sorry, the G. Yes, thank you for pointing that out. It's still true that the mass is cancelled.
Can't do the same sensitivity to the source sensitivity to the source. But isn't that an odd enough? Remember, I think potentially the shape is not a key body, right?
Right. So what the book says, I'm sure the book says the same thing I'm saying, is that this object is moving in a circle. Okay? There are no two ways about it. And if you move in a circle, you're accelerated by this formula. That's all you can say. And notice, by the way, that this force is inward, centripetal. There is no centrifugal force. Do you see a force outward? I don't. Everything is inward or vertical. Centripetal or vertical. Where is the centrifugal force? It does not exist. It's not there. Now, I can tell on some of your faces that you still don't believe me. Right? Because everybody has been talking about centrifugal forces all your life. Why do people think there's a force outward?
Because
the force I practice. You know? I take a scissor, I cut the string. What's going to happen? Well, of course, gravity will not pull it down. But what's going to happen in the circle? If I look down, here's my eye looking down from the top, okay? I see something move along the surface, like this. Not bad circle, is it? Okay? It's moving. Right? M, this is P, etc. And now I cut the string. What will happen? Ignore gravity for a moment. You move on. You cut the string, let's say, you cut the string over here, it will move like this. It will not move from a circle anymore when the string is gone. Because this force is gone. If this force is gone, this force is gone, there's no more centrifugal acceleration. and it starts moving like so. Doesn't that move then? Doesn't that mean there's a force in this direction? Isn't that a centrifugal force doing that?
Momentum.
No? What is doing it? Look at number one. Okay, because this is now I ignore effect gravity. Let's not talk about gravity. Newton number one says it's part of the space, if I ignore gravity, and therefore it will move in a straight line. Okay, then a constant velocity. No centrifugal force anywhere. Just Newton's first law. Of course it's a law, because it's a string and it's gravity, so it will eventually fall on the ground, but before it falls on the ground, it will move into a straight line, it is in the horizontal plane. No centrifugal force. So this is the last time you'll hear me say the word in class. Okay, everyone understand this? I'm doing this especially slow. Yes? So we get all the signs right. We understand exactly how to do it. We write F plus MA in vector notation. We split it up into its components, right? And what you must have been more in the diagram, very big, you see. This I follow my own recipe. I actually follow my own instruction. And and then we draw all the forces, we draw all the components in the x and the y direction, it can go on, right? Go on, things stay. Don't think, oh, there must be a centrifugal force. Oh, no, I said a word again. No, I'll explain to you after the lecture, okay? It's a good question. But I don't really want to take the time right now. Because that depends on my today. I'm going to talk about May. I shall also do the demo. That will be a bigger question. That's very nice. Concept, okay? I'm going to talk about May and Mars. I did that before. I'm going to repeat it. Because it's so important. And when your family member asks you about what is the kilogram and pounds and mass and weight, I want you to be able to explain this in very simple terms. The answer you ask you is not a physicist, right? Or a physicist. So, let's say to the bathroom scale. You do this about once a week, because you have to keep your weight down. That's important. At your age, you don't have any fall. Yes. So I look on the stand on the scale, and I see on the top. You know, my scale has a little window, and I see numbers for it. I'm not going to tell you what my weight is. Okay. It's a person, the stand on the scale, the scale has 132 pounds. Because the scale is in pounds. This is the abbreviation for pounds. LBS. Okay? The scale should show this. It should say the number 132 should be here. And then somewhere along the scale it should say pounds. If it's zero, it should say LBS. Or something like that. I have not seen a scale in the United States that says KG. Here then. I don't know why. Because we in the United States have passed a law that says we'll sell you MKS units. Okay, people have not stress. Maybe they'll never stress, so it says pound. First thing to know, and I want you to know this by heart. There are not many things you have to know by heart, but this is one that you must know. 2.2 pounds is 1 kilogram. Okay? Can't help it. That's just like there is 100 centimeters in a meter. It can't be helped. This is what people have been saying hundreds of years ago. So if I take the 132 and write it over here, and you divide it by 2.2, I believe we get 60 kilograms. So that is my mass. How come that that is my mass? Because isn't it true that when I step on the scale, gravity is pulling on me and I'm putting I'm putting my 2 feet down on the scale, and the scale is reacting to the normal force this way. So this is my, let's say, T1 and T2. This is N1 and N2. and 1 to the T1 and 3 to the T2, the scale will just be compressed by me. And when you compress the scale, it is able to return the vertical force. There's some spring in here, that if you compress the scale, there will be an upward force, because the spring doesn't want to be compressed inside. So it pushes back. Okay? Nowhere do I see mass here. I see weight, right? T1 plus T2 is my weight. But my weight is my mass times g. So how come that the scale doesn't read weight? Pardon me, it should read weight. And not, it should not read mass. Right? Am I right? So the weight is the force to which the earth attracts, the gravity attracts you downwards. And that's what the scale is reacting to. The scale doesn't know your mass. It just only knows your weight, right? The force of gravity that causes the scale to be compressed. The top of the scale is down, the number changes. So what case? How can the scale know what your mass is? But it's really measuring weight. And there's a factor G there, right? They're not the same. This is the weight. W and M by R and O means the same. You better than the same. You know what? The manufacturer stepped in there and then he put the little lines on the scale along here that you see through the window. They put the lines at such a distance that they only put the 9.8 into account. And then they divide it by 9.8. Okay? And they labeled it by the mass. So when you step on that scale, you indeed are reading mass on the window, even though the scale is measuring weight. Don't be confused by these two, right? To make sure you understand this, I'm going to ask you the following question. Suppose I travel to the moon with this scale. Okay? And I can repeat this. On the moon, I put the scale down, and I step on the scale on the moon. Now you should know that here at the moon, don't memorize this, but I know it by heart for some stupid reason. I know, don't know much by heart, but I know that the gravitational acceleration on the moon is about approximately 1/6 of acceleration on Earth. Okay? We'll talk more about that in a few weeks. So, knowing that, you step on the scale on the moon. Here I am. Okay, now it's the moon. I better wear a spacesuit that will make me heavier. Let's not talk about that, okay? I'm wearing a radius and I stand in the background, not very long, I suppose, and I measure my weight or my mass. What will the scale read? Will the scale read my mass? 60 kilograms? 132 pounds? 132 shown in the window here? Or what will it show in the window when I look down?
1/6.
Okay, Chris, Flicker. I see 132 pounds. Your answer? What do I see? 132 divided by 6. Which one of the two should I see? And remember now, mass is independent of where you are, right? It can be in outer space. Your mass is the same. No matter where you are, your mass is always the same. So I lost connection to the days. Thank you. know, the majority base, this is just where it comes from. What happens is when I'm on the moon, this formula is the same formula, but no g of the Earth becomes a g of the gravity of the gravity of the moon, 1/6. It makes this thing 1/6. So my rate goes down by 1/6. And therefore, I'll see this number. Okay? But that's completely wrong. Remember the scale was calculated in kilograms, or pounds, or in mass, I should say. That is only true because the manufacturer used 9.8 meter per second of that. When he put the marks on here, on that circle, okay? And those marks are only correct if you are in gravity with a 9.8 acceleration. On the moon, you're 1/6 of that. Those marks are completely off. You understand? If you buy a scale for the moon, you have to tell the manufacturer, I'm going to use this scale on the moon. And he will change the scale. He will change the distance between each mark and the circle. Is my mass the same when I'm on the moon and on Earth? Yes. How much is my mass on the moon? How much is it? Kilograms, right? It does not change. I even have mass in outer space, but the scale will be zero. And I'm in outer space and I step on the scale, I can't even do it. At the moment I push the scale, it will float away. Yes? Mm-hmm. My mass will reach zero on the scale. Because the manufacturer confused a little bit, he tells you, I'm telling you what your mass is, but he's really telling you what your weight is. And that only works on Earth. Okay, now I'm belaboring the point, maybe even too much. Okay, any question about this? How do I fix this? Suppose I want to measure the mass very accurately. By the way, this number 9.8 is not the same everywhere on Earth, either. Because at the top of Mount Everest, which I don't recommend to do, because the gravity on there for one reason, another reason is people die doing it. But on the top of Mount Everest, the number is lower. Okay? And if you go very deep into the ocean with a submarine and you step on the scale there, the number will be higher. We'll talk about it in about a month or so, 6 weeks. Right? So the scale is very inaccurate when you move the way from the place where he is 9.8. So how can we fix that? Well, here's the balance idea. I don't have the name of this because it's also in the book and it's very easy concept to understand. I have a pivot and I have a seesaw. Okay, they think I move like this. My unknown mass I put here, and here I put the number of known masses. Okay, known. I have a whole bunch of masses. And then I can put the small ones and big ones, and I keep adding them until the balance is horizontal. Then I know that this mass is equal to that mass. And how do I know that? Because the balance is not moving anymore. This force, like gravity, and that force, and gravity, are equal. It's compensating so much. With a ticket here. Yeah? How do I know the mass of these things? Well, I buy a box with masses in the store. And ultimately, those masses have been compared to the kilogram and that's the number of the first lecture. That is how things are calibrated. So you buy a box with weights. I have some here, actually. And you know what they look like. They look like this. Now this one says 5. And then you know what the weight is. You have it balanced. And the balance works on the moon, it works on Earth. Equally well, I always get 60 kilograms. No matter where what he is, right? All that the balance requires is that those two are equal. And if they're equal, then I know that this mass is compensated by mass. And then I just read off from all the weights I put here how much mass I put there. And I have my mass. Okay. I need some more. Is there any questions about this? Weight and mass, you are not any more confused ever. Right? Think this through. Friction. I think we're going to skip this demo. It's a stupid demo. Okay. I don't have that. has to do with the problem that you have been solving already in many different ways to make, you know, and there's a spring here that whose tension you can read here in Newton's, by the way, not in kilograms, because in Newton's, because we do MK, we do the MKS system here, and then I can change the angle, and you see this big change in reading. That's not too well, because I have only 15 minutes left, and we're going to talk about friction. This is, by the way, not from the quiz. I can tell you about the quiz. It also says it in the description of the fleet. No relative motion. No vector product. And chapter 1 through 5, even though I'm talking about chapter 6 now. Okay? And I will not be on the grid. No chapter 6. So attention, we find it on the template of this thick mental line imagination where we say there is a mass on the horizontal surface or a surface at an angle, and we assume there is no friction. Remember, I was always drawing this line because or the offer from substance here that makes the friction very small or zero even. So that's different than weight, and I don't have to talk about friction. Now I'm going to relax that condition, and I'm going to say that let that friction is in the and then surface. And the problem is you're sitting there, like this ball here, there's no friction, right? Only the friction appears when I pull. I feel it. It doesn't want to move. Because, and I hear a noise between the table and the box. The friction appears when I'm trying to pull, then the friction says, no, I don't want this thing to move. It will yield because I pull hard enough. The friction is the opposite direction. And we're going to call it F, small f. That's what the book users do. So if F is zero, if I don't pull, then the friction is also zero. But as I pull, the friction appears. Okay? If I pull a little bit, you see it doesn't move. But if I pull it, maybe I'm pulling a little bit. The friction has built up to such an extent that it exactly compensates for the force I exert. If I keep increasing my force, then eventually it moves. But before it moves, I already have friction. I'm pulling right now, and the box doesn't move. But this thing moves. If I pull gently on the box, and it doesn't move, that must be that F is equal to F, right? Equal and opposite. Not because of movement is going off, but because the box is not moving. And I'm pulling. But there is clearly a maximum value for F. F has a maximum value. How do I know that? Well, because when I pull hard enough, it moves. So if I pull gently, the friction is building up, it doesn't want to yield, and then as I pull harder, the friction is actually losing. It has reached its maximum value. It can't be higher than a certain value we'll talk about to compensate for that force. And this force F wins out over this force, little f, because little f has a maximum. That maximum will calculate. So there's a normal force here, f maximum equals mu times n. This is an experimental fact. The heavier the box, the more friction there will be. Okay? If we make the box twice as heavy, the friction force, the little f, doubles. If I make the box five times as heavy, then the friction, the maximum force, the maximum friction I can have, is also times five. It's certainly proportional to the weight of the box. Yes? To this normal force n. And u is called the coefficient of friction. coefficient of pressure. There's no way that I know to calculate that force, that frictional force. It's something that people have to give you, usually by doing a measurement. There are actually two mu's. Two mu's. Kinetic and static. Static and kinetic. I know the box is static. Static means that it's a movement. When I pull, I feel a certain friction that I need to overcome. Once it moves, I can reduce my force a little bit. I notice that, yes? And you can try this too with an object in your room or something like that. It's hard to get it moving. Once it moves, the friction has to reduce a little bit. Still there, but not quite as big. So that says that it's harder to make a stationary object move initially than it is to keep it moving. Once it's moving, it takes less force to keep it moving. That means the friction is smaller. So I'm going to introduce two mu's. I'm going to say mu static and mu kinetic, and they are not equal. So they have to tell me what they are. So this relationship among F is less than or equal to mu times n. Because F is less than, you have F has to be less than F maximum. And F maximum is equal to mu times n. And you have to pick the right mu. If the object is moving, you pick mu k. If the object is not yet moving, get mu s. How come these two are different? And we have an idea why they are different. Once you're moving, it measures the surface. It's like this. Yes? And the box, I'm going to show the box surface like that. Of course, they're friction. Yes? They're friction, but I don't want to show this one, right? I cannot show this. There's two little lines there. Once the box has to start moving, the box has to go up and down a little bit, you know, to follow those wiggly lines, they have to clear each other. But once it's moving, the box stands a little bit higher maybe, and it moves over the tops of those wiggly lines. You see what I'm saying? Yeah? So they're going, the box is nicely sitting and it's settled down in all these little valleys that I'm actually by accident, the wiggly line over here. But once I'm moving, they're like surfing, okay? They surf the top of the roughness of the surface. If you want to have a very long mu, which means very low friction at here, you know, if a mu very small, that means F maximum is very small, and therefore F, which has to be less than that, is also small. If you want to do that, you have to make the surface very smooth. That is not the oil that you're doing now, the slime oil, the friction of the surface. The oil was kind of filling in the little wiggles on the surface and made it move it very easily. So now, you can do problems like this. You can imagine what happens to do. You can do all the problems again that you did before. And I'm not going to do that because that will be extremely boring. But that's let me indicate to you in the remaining time one of the problems. We have a box sitting on the surface. But now we cannot ignore the friction anymore. So there's friction. How does it work? Well, we have gravity. I'm going to go a little faster because I've done this now several times very slowly. So now I'm going to take advantage of having done that. So I have the mg's. What else do I have? Friction. Which way is the friction pushing? Up or down? Up. Very good. I'm glad to hear that. That is F. And then the people already mentioned that the normal force and are there any other forces? No. Okay. So I'm going to pick a coordinate system. I'm going to take this line this way, and I'm going to take the same equation as here, plus x is x. So f equals ma becomes two relations. F equals ma x and y equals ma y. I have two relations, one in the x direction, one in the y direction. Let's take the x direction. What do I see? Horizontally, I see f. What's the sign of f? What else do I see in the x direction? Yeah, component. I have three components with force, and these two components, right? This one and this one. These two forces.